5-minute debate, not all of them true. So who strayed more from the truth? Tom Foreman takes a look.
Amid new fears of rising crime, a controversial police tactic worked its way into the debate, stopping people and frisking them for minor suspicions. Donald Trump, all for it.
It worked very well in New York. It brought the crime rate way down.
But Clinton knew the facts said otherwise. A spokesman for the police department tweeted, crime kept declining even after the practice was largely stopped, with murders down 80% since 1990. And with a federal judge having ruled against the tactic, Clinton hit Trump hard.
Stop and frisk was found to be unconstitutional, and in part because it was ineffective.
To be sure, Clinton waded into deep water at times, too. At one point, for example, insisting she never flip-flopped over the Trans-Pacific trade deal.
You called it the gold standard of trade deals. You said it's the finest deal you've ever seen.
She does not support it now, but listen to her back in 2012.
This TPP sets the gold standard in trade agreements to open, free, transparent, fair trade.
Still, Trump strayed from the facts more often. On Iraq,
I did not support the war in Iraq.
But listen to him with Howard Stern in 2002.
Are you for invading Iraq?
Yeah, I guess so. I wish the first time it was done correctly.
On women, Clinton insisted Trump is
someone who has said pregnancy is an inconvenience to employers. Who has said women.
But he did in 2004.
The fact is, it is an inconvenience for a person that is running a business.
And on climate change.
Donald thinks that climate change is a hoax perpetrated by the Chinese. I think it's real.
I do not say that.
But there it is in a Trump tweet from 2012. Global warming was created by and for the Chinese. Although Trump took a worse beating than Clinton from fact checkers following this debate, the question is, how much does that matter? After all, in this election, polls have consistently shown voters don't really trust either one of them. Anderson?
Tom, thanks very much. A lot to discuss. Joining me now is CNN senior political commentator and former Obama senior advisor David Axelrod. Also CNN senior political analyst and former presidential advisor David Gergen. First of all, David Axelrod, do you think either candidate moved the needle significantly last night, or even moved the needle just in terms of poll numbers?
The nature of our politics is that there are large blocks of vote that are really set, and so there isn't a lot of movability within the electorate. I think two things happened. One is I think Donald Trump failed to do what he needed to do in terms of giving particularly these college-educated white voters who are key to his success a sense that he has the temperament and has the mastery of substance that he needs to be president. I think she also may have given some more encouragement to some of these younger voters who have been flaking off to the third parties. So she could pick up some vote there. But I don't look for massive changes in the vote as a result of this debate.
David, do you see Donald Trump altering the way he prepares for the next debate based on this debate?
He sure should. He might actually practice, and I think that would make a major difference. And I think what we have seen in stark terms here in the last few days is that the professionalism of the Clinton campaign is beginning to make a difference.
That's what we saw last night.
Yes, that's what we saw last night. And very importantly, it's what we've been seeing today. I agree with David. We don't yet know whether blocks of voters have been moved. We'll have to wait for polls later in the week. Mm-hmm. But what we do know is the dynamics of the race are changing. And he went from a bad light night last night to a terrible hangover today with the momentum changing and the Clinton team going on offense. And today he had one of the worst days of his campaign. He was just being pummeled left and right today. And what is
which he made worse by continuing to talk about
absolutely
there is a pattern to this, though. After the Democratic convention, and when the conclusion was that the Democrats had a much stronger convention and he had been beaten up he went on a long sort of downward skiing in which he had one bad story after another bad story in which he of his own creation. And the question is whether he can handle this debate and the aftermath of this debate in a way that doesn't deepen his problem.
Yeah, and what's really striking to me, and you'll have a chance to interview Ms. Machado here in a few minutes, is we now know that this seems to have been been planned by the Clinton people well before the debate. I mean, she gave an interview to Cosmo magazine some days ago, got the pictures already, so they could publish it today. What were they thinking about? They were thinking this was going to become a big story today.
And Hillary Clinton almost didn't get it into the debate. I mean, it seems like she kind of shoehorned it in the last minute.
You know, she had a strategy, and you could see it from the moment she arrived, to unsettle Donald Trump. She raised what we know is a hot button for him, the fact that he was given money by his father to start his businesses. And you could see her systematically trying to unravel him. And by the end of the debate, she had succeeded.
Yeah.
After the first President Obama debate in 2012, I understand where he did not do well.
Yes.
And last night you were saying you knew within the first 10 minutes of that debate it was not going well at all. I understand you actually showed, is it true that you showed him videotape of what specifically wasn't working and that helped?
Well, there's no doubt we always reviewed tape with him. But we, you know, he needed a whole different approach. He had the wrong approach to that debate. I think he would say that. And he needed to approach it in a much different way. You know, these debates they're not trials of fact. They're not like a courtroom proceeding. They're not a press conference. They're theatrical in nature. And you have to plan carefully how you're going to deal with each question. And the next debate was a town hall meeting, as the next debate will be between these two. So there's the blocking associated with that as well. How you move around
and
the stage.
And how you relate to other people.
Which is going to be very important. Neither of them were particularly evocative last night in terms of talking about people. Here they're going to have to face people and talk to them about their problems. And I think this could favor her in that this isn't Donald Trump's long suit, but we'll see.
It gives her an opportunity to relate to people emotionally and empathically in a way she has not before. But one of the big questions overhanging this debate is she seems to be trying to goad him into bringing up Bill. Mm-hmm. In the second debate. And it looks like
that'd be a huge mistake.
It'd be a huge mistake.
We'll see what happens. Yeah. David Gergen, David Axelrod, thank you very much. Coming up, just as David noted, I'm going to speak with former Miss Universe Alicia Machado, who's now in the middle of the presidential election. She says Trump called her Miss Piggy and Miss Housekeeping. Just today, Trump talked about her weight again. She joins me next.